This slide outlines the design considerations of a pet footing. These are the list of the considerations that you need to check in order to ensure the stability of the foundations, which include the concrete cover, the base size, the moment resistance, the maximum and minimum rebar area, the shear resistance at 1D, the punching shear resistance at 2D from the column face, the punching shear resistance at column face, and also the checking of the maximum bar spacings for the cracking resistance. For the design of the pad foundations, the deflections is not considered. In terms of the concrete cover, you will need to refer to the exposure class in the Eurocode 2, as the pad footing is a substructure and it is normally have a direct contact with the soil. We will expect a higher degree of concrete cover as compared to the other structural elements of the structures, such as beam and slab. In terms of the base size, based on the prescriptive method, it is determined based on the safe bearing pressure as given in this table, based on the serviceability limit state. After you have determined the size of the base, next you need to calculate the bearing stress acting on the pad footing due to the soil bearing pressure, which is calculated in the form of ultimate limit state. That means when calculating the base size, you will use factor of safety of 1.0. While you want to determine the moment resistance of the structures, your factor of safety will be 1.35 and 1.5. The ultimate bearing pressures will be used to determine the moment acting on the pad footings, and you will need to design the reinforcement bar to resist the moment acting on the member. Provide slightly additional bar based on the amount of reinforcement bar required, and check for the maximum and minimum bar areas. Next, you will have to check the foundations in terms of the shear resistance under three circumstances. First is the shear resistance at 1D from the column face. You will need to determine the total shear load generated by the bearing pressure acting at the regions here. That force is converted into the shear stress by dividing with effective sections area here to be compared with the shear capacity of the sections. Your shear resistance needs to be greater than the shear stress. Next, you need to check for the shear resistance at 2D distance from the column face. This will form a perimeter around the columns at 2D distance. Again, you need to quantify the total shear force of the shaded regions here outside the perimeter to be divided by total effective sections area of the perimeter. The shear stress needs to be lower than the shear resistance of the sections. Also, you have to check for the shear resistance of the column face, as indicated by the lines here. The vertical shear load here is determined by the axial loads acting by the columns. The shear load is divided by total surface area along the perimeter of the columns, and the shear stress needs to be less than the shear capacity of the sections. Lastly, you will have to determine the maximum bar spacing in order to check for the cracking resistance.